From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
Hello, and welcome to this JAMA Clinical Reviews podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Karen Lasser, Professor of Medicine at Boston University and Senior Editor at JAMA. Today, I am joined by Dr. Laura Boucai, who is an Associate Professor of Medicine in the Division of Endocrinology at the Weill Cornell Medical College and Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center. Welcome, Dr. Boucai, to this JAMA podcast.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
It's a pleasure. So to begin with, can you talk a little bit about how common thyroid cancer is and how the epidemiology has changed in recent years? Also, what are the risk factors for thyroid cancer?
Sure. I'll start by saying that about 1.2% of the people in the United States will be diagnosed with thyroid cancer at some point during their lifetime. It is estimated that about 44,000 new cases were detected in 2023, and this incidence has gone up three times in the last four decades, mainly due to the widespread use of diagnostic imaging studies that may be conducted for other reasons, and the introduction of fine needle aspiration biopsies that detect early forms of the disease. In addition, the incidence of more aggressive thyroid cancer has also increased, so it is hypothesized that the biology of the tumor may have changed as well. Despite this, the overall survival of thyroid cancer is high, above 98.5% at 5 years. You ask me about the causes or the risk factors for thyroid cancer. Well, the main environmental factor associated with thyroid cancer is radiation exposure to the neck. This radiation could be from nuclear disasters like Chernobyl or Fukushima, or related to external beam radiation therapy that patients receive as part of cancer treatment, for example, for Hodgkin's lymphoma, or what used to be common for treatment of facial acne. Other risk factors, like the presence of thyroid nodules or hypothyroidism, particularly with a high TSH, are also associated with thyroid cancer.
Excellent. And what are the most common symptoms of thyroid cancer?
Well, the vast majority of patients present asymptomatically. As we discussed before, these are detected on diagnostic imaging studies, and patients do not have symptoms. Some patients have their thyroid cancer detected as a palpable nodule on a regular physical exam. Only about 30% of patients present with complaints of a neck mass, difficulty swallowing, the sensation of something stuck in their throat, or hoarseness. And these are typically more advanced forms of the disease.
And when should an incidentally found thyroid nodule be biopsied?
So when patients undergo an MRI, a PET scan, a carotid ultrasound, and a thyroid nodule is incidentally detected, all patients should be referred for a proper thyroid ultrasound. Ultrasonographic characteristics of thyroid nodules are very predictive of malignancy. For example, nodules that are hypoechoic, those with irregular borders, those with hypervascularity or with microcalcifications in them, are at higher risk of harboring a thyroid cancer. And those are the nodules that should be referred for a fine needle aspiration biopsy.
Excellent. And what is the initial treatment and surveillance of well-differentiated thyroid cancer?
Initially, patients should be staged. Patients should visit an endocrinologist or a surgeon specialized in thyroid cancer who would evaluate the extent of the disease. That is, preoperative imaging studies are key to understand the burden of disease. Typically, a thyroid ultrasound can delineate the extent of thyroid nodules, whether they are accompanied by cervical lymph nodes or not, whether they are invading critical structures in the neck, like the recurrent laryngeal nerve, or they are close to the trachea or the esophagus. When these more aggressive forms of the disease are suspected, we rely on neck tomography with contrast to plan an appropriate surgery. And the initial treatment can vary according to the size of the nodule, the location of the nodule, and the rate of growth. For example, very small nodules, less than 1 centimeter in size, can now be observed without being surgically removed. We have data from Japan and from the United States that small thyroid cancers called microcarcinomas grow at a very slow rate, about 15% at 10 years, and spread to neck lymph nodes in a proportion of about 3.6% at 10 years. What that means is that the majority of thyroid cancers that are of small size do not grow and do not spread. And if appropriately located in the thyroid, patients can have the option of active surveillance. We call active surveillance the ability to observe small thyroid cancers over time. And this can be changed over time if the nodule were to grow, if the nodule were to spread to neck lymph nodes. They can be managed with a surgical resection. You ask me how thyroid cancer should be managed initially. Surgical treatment of thyroid cancer is the traditional approach. We can do hemithyroidectomies, that is removal of half of the thyroid gland, for nodules that are contained within one lobe of the thyroid, particularly those that do not have cervical lymph nodes compromised, or if in the preoperative imaging testing we see cervical lymph nodes suspiciously compromised with thyroid cancer, particularly in young patients, we offer them a total thyroidectomy and neck dissections. For medullary thyroid cancer, the traditional approach is to perform a total thyroidectomy with a prophylactic neck, the central neck dissection. These tumors tend to compromise central compartment lymph nodes and sometimes lateral compartment lymph nodes.
And just wanted to back up for a moment. Can you explain which type of histologic subtypes are generally the well-differentiated thyroid cancers?
Yes, that's a great question. We are here talking about thyroid cancer in general, but the reality of the matter is that we treat different types of thyroid cancer in different ways. About 85% of all thyroid cancers are papillary thyroid cancer. And these, together with follicular thyroid cancers and oncocytic thyroid cancers, are called well-differentiated thyroid cancers. Conversely, medullary thyroid cancers arise from C cells, parafollicular C cells within the thyroid gland, and 20% of these are hereditary and given rise by a genetic mutation in the RET proto-oncogene. Those are very different types of thyroid cancer that we treat surgically, but we follow different biochemical markers and we never give the type of adjuvant treatment that we give for well-differentiated thyroid cancer. Mainly, we do not give radioactive iodine for medullary.
Yeah, which brings me to my next question, which is, in which cases should patients be treated with radioactive iodine?
So we give radioactive iodine for three reasons. We give radioactive iodine to destroy normal thyroid tissue remaining from the surgery so that we are able to follow thyroglobulin levels as a thyroid cancer marker. we give radioactive iodine as adjuvant therapy. That is, if we suspect that there is microscopic disease persistent in the neck despite a good surgery from a high-volume surgeon, or we give radioactive iodine when we have structural persistent disease to prevent the growth of disease that we know we are leaving behind. Patients at low risk of thyroid cancer recurrence, that is, patients that we believe are not going to have thyroid cancer come back to their neck after an initial surgery, generally do not require radioactive iodine therapy. Patients with an intermediate risk of recurrence, that is a risk about 20 to 30%, we tend to recommend radioactive iodine even if we do not have proof that there is persistent thyroid cancer after the initial surgery. And patients at very high risk of having thyroid cancer come back in the neck, that is patients who have an aggressive tumor invading critical structures in the neck, or patients with extensive blood vessel invasion that tends to result in distant metastasis, we treat them with radioactive iodine for the possibility that we may reduce their chances of having thyroid cancer come back in the future.
Excellent. That's very helpful. Now, how does molecular testing help in the treatment of advanced thyroid cancer?
So the recognition of molecular testing in the last few years has helped us tremendously, and not only for the treatment of advanced thyroid cancer, but also for the treatment of indeterminate nodules, where the cytology of a nodule is not benign or malignant. For example, we can now test the final aspiration biopsy of a indeterminate nodule and determine better whether the nodule represents thyroid cancer or not. In the context of advanced thyroid cancer, we use the genetic mutation that gives rise to the tumor to predict how it is going to behave. For example, we now understand that there are BRAF-like tumors, those harboring a BRAF mutation or mutations that resemble the behavior of BRAF, that spread through the lymphatic system and tend to compromise lymph nodes in the neck or metastasize to the lung. Conversely, there are RAS-like tumors that tend to spread through blood vessels to distant sites, and the site of metastatic disease tends to be the bones, the liver, the brain. In the former, in the BRAF-like tumors, radioactive iodine tends to work less. So repeated doses of radioactive iodine are generally not indicated. In the RAS-like tumors, those are the ones who maintain the expression of the sodium iodine transporter that the cells have to incorporate radioactive iodine, and those are the tumors that benefit from the treatment of radioactive iodine in repeated doses. In the very advanced metastatic cases, we use the genetic mutation that gives rise to these tumors to target them with specific agents that inhibit the genetic mutation that the tumor has. For example, there are BRAF inhibitors directed specifically to the BRAF mutation. There are MEK inhibitors that work for RAS mutant tumors, or there are NTRK inhibitors directed to NTRK fusions that are very common, particularly in younger kids. So the recognition that there are molecular markers that we can use to target the advanced forms of thyroid cancer has transformed our way of thinking of thyroid cancer, delivering treatment strategies to patients with advanced thyroid cancer, and in particular, in the most advanced and aggressive form of the disease, anaplastic thyroid cancer, we have dramatically changed survival. While historically, anaplastic thyroid cancer had a median survival of 6 months, now we can test anaplastic thyroid cancers, and if we find a BRAF mutation, we can treat anaplastic thyroid cancers with dabrafenib and trametinib and make the tumors shrink and redifferentiate before a surgical approach. Patients on this combination now live beyond 1 year, 2 years, even 3 years after their initial diagnosis.
Excellent. That's really interesting. My last question is whether there's anything else that you think generalists should know about thyroid cancer that we haven't talked about yet.
I would tell generalists that we are moving away from over-diagnosing thyroid cancer, and the United States Preventive Service Task Force has recommended against screening from thyroid cancer when nodules are incidentally found on imaging studies, unless these nodules are large or located in a critical place within the neck that is worrisome for compromise of the trachea, the esophagus, or the recurrent laryngeal nerve. The other point that I want to highlight is that we are also moving away from this idea of one size fits all, of removing the entire thyroid gland and administering radioactive iodine to every patient diagnosed with thyroid cancer. And this concept is being replaced by adapting the treatment strategy based on the actual risk of progression of disease. We now consider strategies like active surveillance of appropriately selective small thyroid cancers, and we benefit from the genomic makeup of the tumors to target the treatment of most advanced forms of the disease.
Excellent. Thank you so much. I'm Dr. Karen Lasser. I've been speaking today with Dr. Laura Boucai from the Weill Cornell Medical College about thyroid cancer. You can find a link to the article in this episode's description. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com or search for JAMA Network wherever you get your podcasts. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. Thanks for listening.